Good morning. Welcome to Lexington Park Baptist Church. We're glad you've come to join in worship this morning. Would you please stand and join us as we open up worship with Forever. For he is good, he is above all things, his love endures forever. Sing praise, with a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. To the setting sun, his love endures forever. By the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. To the Lord, for he is good.
His love endures forever.
His love endures forever.
His love endures forever.
Welcome to Lexington Park Baptist Church, where God is on the move.
Hallelujah.
And hallelujah.
God is on the move.
Please join me in prayer. Father God, we just thank you for this day you've given us. We thank you that you are the faithful one. We thank you that your love endures from generation to generation. Lord, we are grateful today that we can come in here and experience your love, and we can love on one another, and we can know that we have a different kind of love than the world, because it's a love that can only be given by you. God, may we be grateful and worship in that today. May we feel your embrace of each and every one of us, and may we experience the fullness of who you are today. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to worship you. We thank you for this opportunity to get to know you better. We thank you for this opportunity to come together as your people on this day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. So the Word of God says, a joyful heart is good medicine, Proverbs 17:22. Now, if this had been last week, I would have thought they were prophetic with the sled, but I told you all we were going to go from 22 degrees to 68 degrees. Actually, I think it made it almost up to 80 the other day. So is that crazy or what? Woo! That's right, and that's all because of climate change, right? Amen? Yeah. Anyway, I like both the extreme weathers. It was good to have snow, and now it's good to be a little bit warm. And so now you have liquid sunshine outside. So anyway, welcome to our church. We're glad you're here today. If you're our guest, there's a detachable portion of your program between now and the end of service. Please tear that off. Fill that card out. There's a black box in the foyer. Please put that card in there at the end of service. And also, there's a black table out there that has gift bags on it. If you're brand new to us today, please make that our gift to you and take that. And we're really grateful if you do that. And let us know that you're here today. And if you have any feedback, please fill it on the card. Home folk, anything you need to communicate, prayer request, decisions that you may make, that's what this card is for. And also, Wednesday night meals, please fill that card out. Let us know if you're coming to Wednesday nights. So I have some announcements. Speaking of Wednesday nights, Tim Holes, where you at? I didn't get to bother you. Stand up, Tim Holes. Woo, Tim Holes. So Tim Holes is our new discipleship director, and he has hit the ground running. And he's been calling a lot of you. He's been doing focus groups. He's been, yeah, he has, man. What? So he must have called you too, Brian, right? No, okay. Yeah, so he's doing a great job. He's getting information on what we need in the groups, and there's going to be a discipleship meeting coming up in February. So if you're a teacher or a leader, be looking for direction on that. We're going to meet right after church. It's an important meeting, and I'm looking forward to what God's going to do. We're really going to reemphasize right now media. If you did not know that, you go to our website. Every single one in this room and watching online has access to Right Now Media. It has devotionals on it. It has Bible studies on it. And we need to be using that material to educate and disciple our congregation. So some of you are, some of you are not using it. And again, you can deviate from it. And you just need to make sure you're communicating to Tim. And Tim's going to have a master plan of where we're going, a roadmap of where we want the entire church to go as we disciple each other. Because we're supposed to be disciples that... All right, some of you are paying attention. All right, so there's your discipleship training, February 11th, right after church. Make sure you're here for that. All right, we have a special presentation. We have a coat drive going on. Come on up here, coat drive people. Come on, come on. That was weak, church. That was weak. Come on. So, Rhonda, you want to say anything about this coat drive? What's going on? Y'all, come on. This is a fashion show. Show off those coats.
So, first of all, I want to say thank you for everyone who has already donated a coat. So, it was really warm, as Pastor said, this past week. But if you look at the temperature coming up, it is dipping down into the 40s. Brr, right, kids? So, we're asking that when you go out, who likes Target? Who likes Marshalls? And Ross? And Walmart, too.
Walmart.
Absolutely. So this week when you're out shopping, yes, Jeremiah, you too. This week when you're out shopping, we just ask that you pick up a coat for an elementary or a middle school size student and bring it to the church. I have set up a designated spot along the ramp. If you're going down to where you pick up your toddlers and infants, it's on the left-hand side. There are already hooks and hangers. You can hang them up. This is the last week, Sunday. I'm finished collecting coats. We have collected so many coats. So many kids have been blessed with coats these past 2 weeks. God has been so good, and our church was a big part of that. So thank you all so very much, and we really appreciate it. And we're supporting Park Hall Elementary School.
Amen. Let's hear it up. Amen. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you, Coat people. We appreciate you all doing that for us. So I want to encourage you to do that. Also, the police have joined with us, St. Mary's County Police Sheriff's Department, and they brought in several boxes of coats too. So this is a community effort. Please be a part of it, encouraging you to do that. And I do believe, hey, Rhonda, I think they can bring in adult coats too, because parents can get them when they bring in their kids to get the coats. Thank you. So any coat, and it can even be used if it's like brand new, okay? It's in really good shape. So be looking at that. A couple other things. Newcomers class is going to be February 11th, 18th, and 25th, and the 3rd of March. Please sign up for that. Even if you can't make them all, please sign up. I can work with you, have video on some of them. You can watch the video on the ones you miss. And there's a workbook that's all on my LPBC, so we can get that information to you. But please sign up. So if you're new, this is a great time for an opportunity for you to get to know, one, I personally teach the class, so you get to know me as your pastor. And then secondly, you get to know kind of what we believe, what our doctrine is, how we operate, where we would like you to serve, and things like that. So please come out and be a part of that. Emphasizing women's revival, again, March 8th and 9th, there'd be a sign up out there. You can go see the ladies for that. Graduate and professionals, young adults, we are meeting tonight at Nicoletti's Pizza at 6 p.m. Church will be providing the pizza, so please show up if you're in that category of the 18 through 30. Please be there. The only other thing I think I need to do is the photo day right at the end of service today. Hopefully you've been here. If you're a veteran, you're going to meet me out by the flag in the foyer. We have to get all veterans pictures. So please, if you're a veteran or serving on active duty right now, we would like to get your picture. Also, family pictures will be in each corner. So we're doing it this week and next week. So if you would like, we want you to update your photo so that you don't look like my photo. All right. So that's 15 years old. So if you've not had a photo, we would really like to get an updated photo of you and your family and your situation. So if you can, they'll be in each corner of the room after service this week and next week. And so if you didn't color coordinate, my wife and I are an example of that. We did not color coordinate this morning, but the picture's in black and white in the directory, so you're good to go, all right? So everybody will thank you, color coordinated, amen? So see, we're good examples for you for this, right? So with that, I want you to get up now, and I want you to greet some people. Tell them you're glad to see them here today. Okay, if I can have you return to your seats, please. If you can please return to your seats. All right, if you're making your way back to your seats, it's our missionary moment. And for our missionary moment today, we're going to lift up the Southern Baptist Convention and our IMB workers and our North American Mission Board workers. So in general today, also want to remind you that we pray for our Baptist Convention also, and we pray for the PBA, which is the Potomac Baptist Association. Today we're looking at Nancy Porter specifically. She works with Pacific Rim people groups. So we're going to be praying for Nancy and the gospel to go around the world. So please join me as we pray for all these missionaries. Father God, we are grateful that there are those that have devoted their lives to the ministry in a unique, special way. following the patterns of Paul and missionary work of expanding the gospel to the ends of the earth. Lord, following the patterns of the first century church, the diaspora, as they went out and they took the gospel from the Jewish people to the Gentile people. Lord, we are grateful that your gospel can flourish. We pray for the Pacific Rim. We pray for Nancy. We pray that the gospel will flourish in that area through her ministry. We pray for the National Convention. We pray for the BCMD. And we pray for the PBA, God, that you will use all those elements and all those organizations that are here to support the local churches of the Southern Baptist Convention. And God, we pray that you continue to raise up missionaries, continue to give strong leadership and direction, continue to keep us gospel-focused as we take the gospel to the ends of the earth. We pray this in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, amen. Let's stand and worship our great God.
This is our God, this is what he does. waiting. God so loved the world.
Ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no one could ever comprehend. Your word will be enough, your promise we will trust. Greater things are still ahead. You're not done yet. You're not done yet.
God, in my seeking, God, in my dreaming, you put a song in my soul. God, in the working, God, I'm believing, do the impossible. You're not done yet.
No eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no one could ever comprehend. We will trust. Greater things are still ahead. You're not done yet. You're not done yet. You're not done yet. You're not done yet.
You're not done yet. You're up to something right now. Doing a new thing right now. God, let your glory come down. Don't hold back, don't hold back. You're up to something right now.
Doing a new thing right now. God, let your glory come down. Don't hold back. You're moving mountains right now. You're breaking chains right now. God, let your glory come down. Don't hold back, don't hold back.
No eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no one can ever comprehend.
Your word will be enough. Greater things are still ahead. You're not done yet.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Please join me in prayer. Father God, we are grateful that you are not done with your people. We are grateful that you have not given up on us. We're grateful that in our greatest need, you sent Jesus. As a demonstration of your love, Christ died for us. So for all that believe in you, we have eternal life, but also we have new life. We're a new creation. And behold, you make all things new. Lord, today as we continue to build on everything that you've been doing, from the new wineskins that you want us to be as a church and as individuals, to the love that we need to have of forgiveness and grace and mercy that was poured out to the woman who came to wash your feet with her tears. And to today, as we study about a different kind of love, we are grateful that you gave yourself for us, that you demonstrated love for us, and you've given us this great gift that we can love you back and love each other. Lord, may all we do in this place demonstrate that today. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Stay standing, and everybody get out the responsive reading. In your program, you should have this. This is Psalm 136. If you're at home, you can open your Bible to Psalm 136, and you can follow along. Again, that is Psalm 136. So we opened up with, "Forever God is faithful, and His love endures forever." I'm going to read the light print. You will read the dark print. By the time you get done, you're going to be saying, "His love endures forever. His faithful love endures forever." So let's begin. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. Give thanks to the God of gods. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. He alone does great wonders. He made the heavens skillfully. He spread the land on the waters. He made the great lights. The sun to rule by day. The moon and stars to rule by night. He struck the firstborn of the Egyptians and brought Israel out from among them with a strong hand and an outstretched arm. He divided the Red Sea and led Israel through, but hurled Pharaoh and his army into the Red Sea. He led his people in the wilderness. He struck down great kings and slaughtered famous kings. Sihon and king of the Amorites, and Og, king of Bashan, and gave their land as an inheritance. An inheritance to Israel, his servant. He remembered us in our humiliation and rescued us from our foes. He gives food to every creature. Give thanks to the God of heaven. Amen. You may be seated. Jerry Carter, if you can come up, please, as we transition now to our time of giving God back a portion of what He's blessed us with. A reminder that we have the giving boxes up front, and we have the black box by the staircase. At the end of service, you can give that way. You can also give online, and you can also go to our website and give that way as well. Thank you, as always, for your generosity. Jerry Carter, you're probably a little off kilter because you normally sit back there, and you and Karen had to move today. So, everybody, if you don't know, this is Jerry Carter.
Good morning. I'll be reading from Malachi 3, 7 through 12. Since the days of your ancestors, you have turned from my statutes. You have not kept them. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord of armies. Yet you ask, how can we return? Will a man rob God? Yet you are robbing me. How do we rob you, you ask? By not making the payments of the tenth and contributions. You are suffering under a curse, yet you, the whole nation, are still robbing me. Bring the full tenth into the storehouse, so that there may be food in my house. Test me in this way, says the Lord of armies. See if I will not open the floodgates of heaven and pour out a blessing for you without measure. I will rebuke the devourer for you, so that it will not ruin the produce of your land, and your vine in your field will not fail to produce fruit, says the Lord of armies. Then all the nations will consider you fortunate, for you will be delightful land, says the Lord of armies. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for all the many blessings that you give us. Father, we just pray that you watch over us and guide us as we go through our service and through our life. Be with the sick, comfort them. Be with our church. We ask these things in your name and pray that your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Good morning. As she made her way to Jesus, she stumbles through the tears that make her blind. She felt such pain. Some spoke in anger, heard folks whisper, "There's no place here for her kind." Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard as she poured her box of alabaster on her master. "And I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. You weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his loving arms around me. Cost of the oil in my alabaster box. I can't forget the way life used to be. I was a prisoner from the sin that held me bound. And I spent my days, poured my life without measure into a little treasure box I thought I'd found. Until the day when Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonders of his touch. So now I'm giving back to him all the praise he's worthy of. I've been forgiven, and that's why I love him so much. And I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair, my hair. For you weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel when he wrapped his loving arms around me. And you don't know the cost of the oil. You don't know the cost of my praise. You don't know the cost of the oil in my eyes.
Let's get our Bibles out. Let's raise the Word of God high. Say this with me. This is my Bible, God's holy Word. I'll make a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path, and hide its words in my heart, that I might not sin against God. So Shawnetta singing that song should take us back, because I know you all pay attention to my sermons every week. That's what I preached last week. So we're building from this, the new wineskins that we must be, that God wants to pour new into us, to make us new, to do make us a new creation, that God is never done with us. So if we become old wineskins, we might as well die and go to heaven, because we're no longer used by God. We need to be this new vessel that God can use afresh and anew. And we looked at Mary, and we looked at her turning suggesting, Jesus, you can fix this. And then Jesus turned water to wine and then brought the best for everyone because they listened to Jesus. Then we've looked at last week this woman that came that's a sinner, that is not invited, that is not welcome in church, that's not welcome in Simon's house. She's an outcast, and she comes in with her tears and her hair and her kisses on his feet and her perfume. And she anoints Jesus. And then Jesus sends her away, her sins forgiven, with salvation and with a new reputation. God wants to do that for you and me. And then today I want us to look at this new love. God has a new love for you. And here's something that we all need to be aware of. Ephesians, the church in Ephesus, when we get to Revelation, there are seven churches listed. One of them is the church in Ephesus. They were a great church. They did great things. They preached the word of God, but they forgot their first love. So God warns us, Christians, not to forget our first love. The love that changed that woman, the love that changed you when you first experienced Jesus Christ, never forget that love. It's not about what we know. It's not about being legalistic. It's not about following the law. Those are all can be important things. We want to be moral people. We want to be righteous people. But if we lose the love of God, we've lost everything. And so today I want to talk about this different kind of love. And this different kind of love is not just the love that Christ loves us with, but that we're supposed to love each other with. And sometimes we get so confused. And by the way, I want everybody to understand this. There are broken people in this room right now. Some are more broken than others. But I guarantee you, every single person that stepped in these doors today can relate to that woman we spoke of last week. There's something in your life. I'm not going to give you examples, because then somebody may say, you're picking on me. But it can be a ton of things. It could be emotions. It can be you having a pity party. It can be self-righteousness. It can be a laundry list of things that you've come in here and you're broken over, and you need to sense God's love again in your life. Christian, that's you and me. That's all of us, every single one of us. So this love of a different kind. If someone was to ask me, what is God? God is love. God is love. Now I know you're saying, wait. What about holiness? What about justice? What about righteousness? What about his wrath? You know, what about all these other things? By the way, God is all those things too. But God is love. Why is God just? Because he's love. Why is God merciful? Because he's love. Why will God judge us accordingly to his word? Because he is love. Why does he discipline us? Because he's love. God is defined in the Bible as love. In fact, it says it that way. John walked with God. John walked with Jesus. He knows way better than you and me. And he says, God is love. Now, he's all those other things too. But his love is what motivates everything. This is a huge difference between people that like believe God's wrath is what drove Jesus to the cross versus God's love drove Jesus to the cross. I'm telling you, your pastor believes this. Why Jesus went to the cross was because he loved you and me. If we ever lose that, if we ever get in these theological mindsets that take us away from that, slap yourself over the head with a 2x4. God is love. God is love. To know God is to know love. People sometimes will ask me, what is he? He's love. God is love. 1 John 4:8. It's just background stuff till we get to the primary text in 1 Corinthians. The one who does not love does not know God, because God is love. Boy, can John say it any clearer than that? Listen, and if you don't love, you don't know God. Now you say, wait a minute, I love. The world loves. Yeah, they love a different type of love. Our love is a love that God gives. Do you love like God? Because if you do, then God's love resides in you and God abides in you. And you should be able to share that love with each other. 1 John 4:16, the same chapter. We have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love. Once again, can he be any clearer? God is love. The one who remains in love remains in God, and God remains in him. Let's pause for a moment. I'm going to ask you to do something that's very weird. Something that will make some of you very uncomfortable. Right now in this room, I don't want you to do what I'm about to tell you to do to your wife or your husband or your children. Cannot be a family member by flesh and blood. You have to find somebody else besides them. And I want you right now, if God resides in you and God loves resides in you, and you hug somebody. Come here, Billy Davis. I love you, brother.
I love you too.
I just gave him a God hug, and he just gave me a God hug. Because God's love's in him and God's love's in me. So I want you to find somebody right now, appropriately, like you just saw me demonstrate, and say, I love you, brother or sister in Christ, and hug somebody other than your spouse or your husband or your children. Go. Do it right. All right, you can return to your seats. If you did not get a God hug, see me after church. If you didn't get a God hug, see me after church. God loves you. Man, we can't be any clearer. God is love, and God's love needs to abide in us. We should do love well. We should be the best lovers in the entire world. We should be able to take the love of God and apply it to our lives, let it change us, and then give that love out. God's love in the Old Testament is mostly known as Hesed, H-E-S-E-D. It's a faithful love. It's an abiding love. It's a love that's like his love endures forever. That is Hesed. So when you read that today, you were saying God has said. God's love endures forever. God loves me with a faithful, enduring love that will never go away. Isn't that amazing? Our love will fade. Listen, our love of our spouse could be dependent upon what they did that day. Our love of our children can be dependent upon the love of what they did that day. I mean, your love of your pastor could be, he didn't step on my toes today. Our love can be defined by circumstances. God's love is defined by faithfulness. So should our love. His said, God's steadfast, unfailing, unwavering, faithful love. Agape, this is the one you're used to because it's Greek, and we usually study this one. Agape love, that God agapes you. For God so agaped you, he gave himself selflessly for you. It's a love that does not seek its own. It's a love that seeks the good of the other. When we love each other, we should be seeking the good of one another. What does Christ want for us in that love? How can I love you like Christ? And then you should be doing the same back. And when we love with agape love, there's a selfishness to it, but it's not selfish. When we love with agape love, we're actually benefiting ourselves too because we're benefiting the good of the other. So God is benefited. Not that he did it, but he's a benevolent God. He has benefited from loving you this way. He selflessly loves you for your good. By the way, that brings him glory. That brings him happiness. That brings him great joy that he can love us that way. Love should do that for us too. A couple other things I want to go into the background of. 1 Peter 4:8. Love covers a multitude of sin. Listen to this. Above all, church. Above all, it means above everything else that you could possibly do. Maintain constant love for one another. And since love covers a multitude of sins, maintain love, constant love for one another, because love covers a multitude of sins. Listen, I'm not talking about heinous sins. He's not talking about sins, even though we still love people that have really trespassed against us too, though. But really what he's speaking to is if we love this way with each other, that we're able to say, you know what, you annoy me. Somebody on the side, you annoy me. I don't know, I'm just picking on you, all right? Somebody in the middle, man, you are such a disappointment. And somebody on this side, I am just totally disgruntled with you. And if I let that in my heart, disappointments, differences, disagreements, disgruntledness, annoyances, because by the way, we all have annoying things about us. How do we learn to overcome those things? We love. Because love will cover the multitude of those sins. God's love enables you to love the person despite those things. I promote this to my discipleship class, How to Hug a Porcupine. It's a great book. It is a book, it's real thin, you need to read it. And it goes through and it says, normally everything, it describes one type of personality and how you would hug them. You know, from the person like that gets up and has their little quills going ready to spike you from the very beginning, they talk to you, right? To the person that's kind of chill, but then if you get on their nerves, they can like turn around and cut you. But the last chapter is, remember, the porcupine might be you. And how do you hug a porcupine? Very carefully. With tender, loving care. So you don't get them infuriated to where they poke you or stick you or spike you. So you love and you learn to deal. How do you do that? You love by covering a multitude of sins. So love enables us to look past some things that may not be really, really important. So we can love like Jesus Christ, and we can cover those sins with the blood of Christ, because Jesus' love covered all of our sins, our heinous sins, our sins of betrayal, our sins of grievous sin, even while he was in the act of dying for us, and we were in the act of being a sin. Sinners, Jesus died for us. Romans 5:8. Then John 15:12 through 14. We love because we're part of God. If you belong to Jesus, you're connected to him. The vine and the branches, this whole chapter in 15. And listen to what he says. This is my commandment. This is Jesus, this is my commandment. That you love as I have loved you. You love as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, than to lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I have commanded you. This is a different kind of love. Does the world love this way? No. Does the world want to cover a multitude of sins with their love? No. Do we want to follow a command that says I'm supposed to love like Jesus loves? I'm not supposed to think of myself. See, the world thinks in what the Greek word is called eros, an erotic love that's self-seeking. That's how we, by the way, by nature, that's how we'll love. By nature, we naturally tend to move that direction. We have to make ourselves love like chesed or like agape. We have a different kind of love, a love that should change us, a love that should change how we treat each other, a love that should be modeled in our marriages, in our parenting, in our relationship with our pastor, in our relationship with each other in this room, in our relationship with our coworkers, in our relationships with the person we go to when we buy this coat from Walmart or Target or wherever you go today. That love should be imminent in you, changing you, and should resonate to other people. They should see in you something's different. Let me tell you about this guy. His name's Brad. He worked at Lowe's. And Brad in Cuyahoga Falls. And he still asks Bill Moore, a great, great godly man, in his 90s. He always says, Brad told me to tell you hi. Brad would work the cash register. And I'm in Lowe's more than I ever want to admit, by the way. It just on the record. So I'd go to Lowe's and there was Brad. And he was so joyful. He just radiated. He oozed. I said, Brad, are you a Christian? He goes, how'd you know? I'm like, that's how I knew. He goes, are you one too? I was like, yeah. And he goes, that's awesome. And we're hugging in Lowe's for the first time we ever met. And then we had this love relationship. Seriously, in Lowe's. And this guy just oozed the love of God. It radiated off of him. You knew it just by his behavior. Just by how he held himself and conducted himself and how he treated people. At Lowe's. And so I just want to encourage you. Do people see that in you? Does God's love ooze out of you? Do people see that joy in you, that excitement in you, that difference in you? Because we're to love different. We should look different. We should love different. And we should do it well. Church should be a place where we experiment and experience true love in Jesus Christ. And it should then go to our family. It should then go to every aspect of our lives. But here in church, listen, don't worry about outside yet. Here in this church, love is expected. Here in this church, all those things I just talked about, God is love, we should know God, we should greet each other with God, love covers a multitude of sins, we should be connected, we have this new commandment to love as Jesus. Is that expected of each of us? Everybody say yes.
Yes.
Love that way. God is love. And if you know God, you will love that way. So, we get to 1 Corinthians 13. Who's been to a wedding? It's read at weddings a lot. It really is not a wedding text, by the way. It's just a love text. And it's about the love of God. And by the way, I want you to know right now, you are married to Jesus because you belong to the church. So you are in a love relationship with Jesus that is about oneness, about intimacy, and about loving God back, and it should penetrate every aspect of your life to where you love with that love that God has for you and that relationship you have with Him because we belong to His church. So this love is a description of how we're to love. And so I don't want you to think of it just for a wedding or marriage. I want you to think about your life and relationship to Jesus as I read these words. I'm going to read starting in verse 4, 1 Corinthians 13. And we will go to the end of the chapter. Verse 4, starting off. It says, love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy. It is not boastful. It is not arrogant. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not irritable. Come on now. Watch this next one, man. Just get ready to get hit in the gut. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love finds no joy in unrighteousness. It only rejoices in truth. It bears all things. It believes all things. It hopes all things. It endures all things. Love never ends. But where there is prophecies, they will come to an end. Where there is tongues, they will cease. Where there is knowledge, it will come to an end too. For we know in part, but listen, what do? We know in part and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I used to speak like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man, when you became a woman, you put away those childish things. For now we see only a reflection like it's in a mirror. But someday we will see face to face. And now I know in part, but then I will fully be known and I will fully know. Now these three things remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. May God add a blessing to His holy word. The greatest thing you can ever do, the supremacy of love. Can we love like that? So just for a moment, I want to look at these things, and I want you to do a gut check on yourself. Love is patient. What's that mean? It's long-suffering. It puts up with a lot of garbage. Love is long-suffering. It is patient. Even when you think we shouldn't be patient, listen, love should change how we treat others because we're patient. Because love leads us to that conclusion. Love will suffer the ignorance of others. Ooh. Love will suffer with the ignorance of others. Love will also, listen, errors, infirmities, and transgressions from your children of God, brothers and sisters in Christ. If we're patient with each other, we endure those things patiently. Doesn't mean we give a pass. Doesn't mean we give an excuse. Doesn't mean we say, we're just going to forget about that sin. No, we're in there, but we're patiently loving them in that situation. Like no parent's ever done that. And then we won't do it for each other. Love is kind. This means mild or gentle. This means tender towards another. Now, I know, gentlemen, you don't want me to come up and caress your face. And do not give me a holy kiss. But we should gently approach each other in love. We should treat each other in a way that's mild and gentle and kind and good for the person. And that's how we're to love not just our spouses and our children, but each other. This is written to the church. This is written to the church. That's how we are to love. Love is not envious. It takes pleasure in the success of others. When someone else succeeds and is blessed, I am blessed. Come on, we need to rejoice when something good happens for somebody. In fact, we're supposed to honor those who need honor. We're supposed to bless those that need to be blessed. We're supposed to love all people. And guess what? When something good, when they rejoice, we rejoice. When they mourn, we mourn. Love is in it. Love is invested. It's not envious. Love's not boastful. It does not seek its own glory. It doesn't elevate itself. Love will always look to the good of the other. Love is not arrogant. It's not puffed up. It is confident, but it's not puffed up. And I did this in my class this week. There's a difference between confidence and arrogance, but sometimes it's a fine line. We should confidently love one another, not arrogantly love one another. We don't love out of pride of what I get. I love because I'm confident in Christ and He calls me to love you. Why am I so passionate? Because I'm confident in Christ. Why am I so convicted about what I preach? Because I'm confident in Christ. If it becomes boastful or arrogant, then the glory is about me instead of God. The same is for you in your life. God wants you to make the focus Him. And the love that we have for each other is not about boasting or arrogance. It's also not rude. We don't discard one another. So, can we say that again? Listen, I do not, yeah, thank you. Go ahead, yes. We do not discard each other. She's getting it down here. Listen, I got to be careful when I say this. I don't care. I care about you. I don't care about your past. I care about what you're doing now and what the future's going to be for you. I care about what God's doing now in your life. And whatever God's doing now in your life, I'm not going to discard that ever. If God is involved in your life and He's changing you and you're loving like Jesus and He's working on you, there may be some correction and some guidance and things that need to happen. That's what pastoring is. There needs to be some equipping and encouraging, all those things. But we are in this thing together, and all of us are important regardless of our role. Regardless of who we are or what we think we are, or we think we're more successful to another, love does not work that way. And if I work that way, or you work that way, we're not operating in love. Amen? Amen? Love is not self-seeking. It doesn't profit to take advantage of another person. We don't do that. I do teach my kids this, though, because I know that you love me and love my kids. Sometimes it's who you know that helps you in life. And that should be motivated by love. Not irritable. Oh, come on now. You ever get irritated at somebody? Ever get frustrated? Let's do it this way. Anybody been irritated or frustrated with someone this week? If you said no, you're probably not true, all right? Love doesn't move us to irritation. It should move us to get beyond that so that we can love the person. It's hard. It is hard. When you get frustrated and irritated, it's hard. When you get angry or disgruntled or bitterness, I've preached on this before. Anger, disgruntled, bitterness, it's hard to overcome those things. I'm going to tell you, there's only one way, love. That's it. That is the answer. And you also hear me say this a lot. The only answer that you ever need is Jesus, because he is love. Keeps no record of wrongs. But pastor, you don't know what he did. He is late for dinner every night. He's just an annoyance, pastor. They won't clean their room, pastor. They irritate the bejesus out of me. How can I discard that? How can I look away from this or that? Now look, there may be some serious things, so I'm not making light of this. Serious things and serious sins may require more hard work. But the bottom line is, we're not supposed to keep a tab. We're not supposed to keep a record. We're not. In other words, what this really means is, I'm not to think evil of you, I'm to think of the best in you. I am to give you the benefit of the doubt. You are to give me the benefit of the doubt. I am to assume that you're operating out of love until you prove otherwise to me. I'm not to keep a record of wrongs. Now, if somebody does offend me, or somebody does have a serious sin between me, then that takes it to a new level. But that can still be forgiven by the blood of Jesus and made right through a restorative process. But on the basic operation, love does not seek to keep a record of wrongs and keep a tab of what you have or have not done. Now, I'm just going to be honest. We do that to each other. And we do it to the people we're supposed to love the most, like our spouses and our children. We keep that record of wrongs. We're not supposed to do that. So, also, joy, there's no joy in unrighteousness. God is not an unrighteous God. He's a righteous God. He rejoices in the truth. Truth should bring us joy. The truth of God's word brings us joy. It's not easy. For example, when we have someone we love that's misaligned with the truth of God's word, that's hard. Or when our life is not aligned with the truth of God's word, we're out of alignment, but God still loves and wants to bring us back to the alignment. We want to see love change a life and bring them back into a right relationship with Christ in our lives and in others. It says that love bears all things, believes all things, endures all things. Listen, love can put up with a lot of stuff. Love should guide us to be able to put up with each other, even ourselves. Some of you have struggles loving yourself. And I get that. Maybe you've been a letdown. Maybe you've got a big bag. Maybe life's not turned out the way you wanted to. That doesn't change the love of God from you. Circumstances will never change God's love for you. Nor should it make you look at yourself less. You need to look at yourself through the eyes of Christ, who died for you, regardless of your sin. He died for you. Love never fails. Love is always. Listen, the word of God will last forever. We know that, right? There's certain things that God specifically says. I want you to get this. Love is one of those things, too. God's love will never end. When you go to heaven, God's love doesn't end. When this world will be gone and the rapture has happened and everything's said and done and the final judgment is done, God's love will never end. God's love will endure for all of eternity, forever be extended to you and me. And out of those things that remain of faith, hope, and love, love is the greatest. Love is the one that can conquer things in our lives. Now, I know some of you are still sitting in here. I just don't feel like that. Of course, I don't know how the love of God can fix this. There are some things that God can't fix because of sin, but God's love is always there. And God's love may not change the other person, but it can change you. And you need to let God's love do what God's love needs to do in your life, praying for the good of the other person or people or group or whatever it might be. Praying that God's love can do the things that only God can do, that even while we're enemies to God, Christ died for us. So as we consider the love of God for us and the love that we have for one another, may we be known by this love. And now I want to pivot. If someone in here, though, needs the love of God for their salvation, I want you to stay in that moment. If you need God's love for the very first time in your life, when we get to the altar call at the end, I want you to come up. I want you right now in your mind, because I got to change and talk about some other things. I want you to keep in that moment right there and say, I need the love of God. If you're in here and you know that you have not been loving as God has called you to love and there's something you need to lay at the altar today, I want you to remember that right now. And I want you, when we get to the end of the service, to be able to come up here and lay that on the altar and say, I choose to love. I choose to love. Either I receive the love of Christ for the first time today, or I choose, I've abandoned my first love, or I'm having these issues with whatever it might be. Today, I return to my first love. So right now, I want to turn to preparing you for what's coming up. These three last sermons have been done on purpose. The three last sermons have been about being a new person in Christ, this new identity that we have in Jesus. And then it's been about this mercy and grace that we must have like we had towards the woman who came in and washed the feet of Jesus. And even though Simon and the Pharisees condemned her, Jesus received her. And then we're also going to talk about this, how love should guide everything we do. And I'm going to use the example of marriage and divorce over the next several months. Everybody in here has been either influenced by marriage or divorce. Yes? Amen? Every single one of you. I'm not going to have you raise your hands because I don't want to embarrass anybody. But I bet everyone in this room knows someone that's close to them that's been divorced. I bet everyone in this room knows somebody that's been married. Amen? Amen. Marriage is a thing that's common in our society. It's a thing that's common in the church, but it's something that divides us. It divides our culture. Now they've redefined marriage. We're going to go what marriage really is. So as you come here, we're going to talk about why marriage is one man and one woman. It's really important. God has established that for a reason. That marriage expresses the love of God. There's also a reason God has called us his bride, the church and the bride. There's also a reason why Jesus says we have been unfaithful to him. And then there's also times where divorce happens in circumstances and people can never get past it, and it's held against them. As your pastor, I want you to hear this as straight as I can be. That is wrong. Amen. Can I be any clearer? I've got one person that agrees, so everybody else doesn't agree. I've got a lot of work to do. The church has believed in something that's wrong. Our faithfulness and our love for one another and the enduring love that we have in marriage and even through the brokenness of divorce, that love of God never changes. That love we have for each other never changes. A person should not walk through this door and feel like that woman. Ever. Ever. Can we say ever?
Ever.
Just like I don't want to know what your sins are. There are things in my past I don't want you to know about. I don't want you to know because you think less of me. Why would I go dig that up? I wouldn't, because love doesn't tell me to keep that record. I care about you now. I care about what God's doing now. I care about what God's going to do and use you into the future of this church and in your lives and in the marriage that you're in now and the family that you're in now and how God can use all of us for his glory now. And I hope that the sermons I've preached have led us to this point where we can deal with some tough issues, because I believe one of the things the church has been rightfully taken a position on marriage but has wrongfully looked at people that have been divorced. God uses marriage as a reflection of his love. It's a relationship with him and Israel. It's a relationship with Christ and his church. And he tells us that we all have been unfaithful to him. We've seen the pain of these things. We know that the sacredness of marriage is important. We know that the commitment and covenant of marriage is reflective of God. And so it needs to be important to us. It's a covenant that we have between a husband and a wife is very similar to the covenant that God had with Israel and the covenant that God has with us as his church. We need to take it very seriously. We need to love like Jesus in our brokenness. We need to learn how to love through brokenness. We need to learn how to forgive one another in brokenness. We need to know that God's forgiveness and restoration is for anything that has ever been broken. No sin is different than the other. Did you know that Paul was a murderer? Man, he couldn't serve in this church. We would disqualify him. the greatest missionary and pastor and preacher that we know from the scriptures. We need to be careful. We need to look at a person's life that's been changed and how they're living now and into the future. And love is how we do that. God is love. And if we know God and we love like God, His love should just ooze out of us. Let's make sure we're loving that way. God is into restoring broken people. That's you and me. Stop. I don't care what your sin is. Maybe you've managed to avoid some biggies. Maybe you never became a drug addict. Maybe you weren't a prostitute. Maybe you never committed adultery. Maybe you've never fornicated. Maybe you've never been through a divorce. Maybe, you know, you've just been a goody two-shoe, and the worst thing you've done is maybe you didn't clean your room up as a kid. Your brokenness is still brokenness. Your sin still requires the blood of Jesus. And when the blood of Jesus atones sin, it's gone. It's not for us to keep a record of that wrong. Now, again, I want to make sure, you know, there are things that are big things, right? Obviously, there are things you got to work through. But as a general rule, that's how we should operate. When someone comes with repentance in their heart and they acknowledge the sin of their past and they acknowledge who they are now and that God is working on them, we're there. Your pastor's there. And if I have ever treated you differently than that, please forgive me. Did you hear me? If I've ever treated you differently than that, or you have misunderstood something that I've said or done, forgive me. Because I love you. I love you. And if I'm ever bold with you and push back on you because I don't feel you're aligning with God's ways, know that I still love you. Know that I love you. Know that God loves you. We're in this thing together, and I'm in a tough position because God has called me to push the church to be more like Jesus. That is not an easy task. Because I'm not like him either. But I want to be more like him. And I want you to be more like him. Whether it's in your marriage or if it's in something else, it always should look the same. The brokenness that we have, God redeems. God wants us to learn how to love differently. It may be in our relationships in this room, our friendships, family, society. You name it. God's love is not just going to be focused as I talk about marriage and divorce. It's about everything. It's about your relationships in this room. Have you been faithful to them? It's about your relationship to this church. Are you faithful to the church? Because we're supposed to be faithful to Jesus Christ through his church. Right? Are we really loving each other? Are we just complaining all the time? Are we nitpicking all the time? Do we just have a critical spirit all the time? Come on, say nobody does that. It's so easy to get there, amen? It's so easy to get there and get critical. Listen, if you're in leadership, there's no way you can please everybody. Jesus didn't either. But you know what? I love you enough, I hope I can. But here's what I want to tell you. The next couple months, you will see the true me. And I hope you still love me after that. Because I will not compromise on this issue I'm going to talk on. Because I believe the love of God calls us to forgive, to love each other, and to receive God's love. So I want to end back with this text. Oh, I want to say something else. Holy Spirit moment. There's some of you in here hurting. Because the moment I say the D word, it's a scarlet letter on your forehead. And you feel it every time you walk in the doors. You feel it everywhere you go. You feel like a failure. I want you to hear this from your pastor, and I think this is from God. You are not a failure.
That's right.
And God loves you.
Yes, he does.
Just like he loves me, and just because I've been married 32 years, and I'm grateful for those 32 years. And by the grace of God, Shawnetta has learned that love covers a multitude of sins. Maybe you weren't that lucky. But God loves you. And whoever you may be, maybe you're in here and you're struggling because your children have gone through this. Maybe they didn't get married the way they did. Maybe they were shacking up before they got married. No parents ever seen that. Yeah, uh-huh. I'm not here to judge that either. I'm here to love those people to get right with God. Whatever you've been through, wherever you're at, God's love needs to prevail over each and every one of us. So let's end with this so that we truly go back to what God wants from us. 1 John 4:8 and 1 John 4:16. The one who does not love does not know God, because God is love. We have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and the one who remains in love remains in God, and God remains in him. My pledge to you, and the pledge you should do to yourself, and the pledge we should do to each other in this church, is that I'm going to love like that. We should remember the love that Christ had for us, that he died for you and me. And I want the love of God reflected in me. And I would say this, the older I get, and I know some of you are saying, wait, I know, Jerry, wait till you get to my age, Pastor Chris. I got you, man. I think I'm learning to love more. And I think I'm learning to love better. Some of the things that I was more divided over and had more opinions over, and I thought this and this and this, the more I love God and the more God's love is in me, the more he's changed me. So I know all of us are going to be in different places in this room. But the one place we all need to focus on is the love of God. And if we do that, we're going to learn to love God. We're going to become new wineskins. God's going to do new things in our midst. This church is going to be known by its love. And by the way, they'll know you are Christians by your love, by the love that we have for one another. Because the greatest commandment we had is to love like Christ. Look right here. You see this every single week. This is our number one value. This is our number one value, though. We have four values up on this wall you see every single week. The number one value of our church is that we love God and we love one another. Let's do it better. Amen? Amen. Let's do it like Jesus. Amen? Amen? Let's let the love of God change us and rearrange us. And if you're struggling, what have I shared with today? This is the second altar call appeal. The first one was, if you had some personal stuff you need to lay at the altar, and if you need Jesus' love for the first time in your life, you need to come forward. This next one's for all of us. If you are struggling with what I just said, I'm begging you, come lay it at the altar today and choose love. I'm begging you in Jesus' name. I'm begging you to choose love. And let's see what God does. Because there's a reason I'm preaching on this. It's heart issues. It's not really about divorce or marriage. It's about our hearts loving Jesus. What did he say? If you are going to follow me, you must love like me. You must love like me. I want to love more like Jesus. Amen? Amen. Do you want to love more like Jesus? Amen. Then let's go to last week's sermon. You love like he loved that woman. Your sins are forgiven. You've been saved by your faith. Now go in peace. Every week that should happen in this place. Amen? Amen? Every single week that should be happening here. Let's pray that we get there. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you. Truly, God, we just pour our love out to you today. We thank you that you loved us first. We thank you that you're our first love. We thank you for a reminder today that love bears all things, endures all things, it never ends, it's patient, it's kind, it keeps no record of wrongs, all the things. We're thankful that the scripture tells us that you are love. And in this moment, no matter what our heart is, wherever our heart might be, or how broken we may be, or how much we think we got to act together, God, may your love come in. May your love come in and reveal to us the love that you have for each person in this room. And Lord, as pastor, I'm privy to know things that are going on in people's lives sometimes. And I know the hurts. I know the pains. I know some of the past issues. I know some of the stuff that people are going through right now. And God, they need your love. They need your love desperately. We need to experience that love right here in this room. God, as we started off hugging each other with the love of God, may we leave here loving each other the same way, no matter who it was. We hug them. We love them. We move forward together because, God, you are love. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I know you've never heard this word, but there's a Hebrew word called yada. Who's heard yada? Everybody say yada. Yada is sometimes related to marriages for sexual intimacy. Didn't think you were going to say that in church today, did you? But it's the same word that God says we're supposed to yada him back. Yada is this intimate love that we can share with God that makes us vulnerable and trusting of God and that we give him all of who we are. Today, I want you to yada God. I want you to truly let God yada you back. I want you just to not worry about who's around you at this altar call. I don't want you to worry about, hey, what's somebody going to think if I come up? I want you just to thank God. I want to yada with you and you yada back with me. This is our moment. This is an intimate moment with you and with God. I know that's hard to do in a public place. But when you leave here, I know you're all going to go around away knowing this. Yada! Yada God. Let's pray again. Father God, as you call people near to you, Lord, I have to believe that your yacht is in this place right now. You're drawing us near to you. You're desiring intimacy with each of us. May we not push you away. May we open our hearts to you right now for salvation, for decisions in our lives, whatever it is, God. May you draw us near and may we respond back to you with the same yada that you're wooing us with right now. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and sing, "You Come as the Lord Leads You."
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from the waters lifted me, now saved am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. All my heart to him I give, ever to him I cling. In his blessed presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true, merits my soul's best songs. Love, loving service to him belongs. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Souls in danger look above, Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by his love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea, billows his will obey. He your Savior wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, and from the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. Nothing else could help, love lifted me.
And all God's people said,
amen.
May love lift us and take us to new horizons. Amen. and that newness of God. So before we leave and end in a blessing, don't forget, each corner will have somebody with a cell phone. Give Nikki time to get those people out. Who's the first one? Melissa, come on up, your front organ side. Paul, your piano side. So if you have a favorite photographer, you can go see them. You need to make sure you check the data, make sure your information is correct. We have Wayne is in the back on the piano side. You're back there in the back. And Macy Joy will be over on this side in the back. All right? And then I will be out in the foyer by the flag for anyone that has served our nation. We want to get a picture of you, whether you're serving now or you're a veteran. So let's end in a blessing. May the Lord God bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May he lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Go in Jesus' name. Amen.